Leadership and Self-Deception. Right? Mm-hmm. We've referenced that book several times. If you haven't read it, go get it. In the book, there's a concept of self-betrayal and the emotional baggage that that creates. And when I think back on the times that I was wrestling with substance abuse and neglecting every other thing in my life, it was the product of resentment that I built in because of self-betrayal. I was betraying myself by not acting on the things that were the most important to me because I had this other box of crap to check off that really didn't contribute to the degree that I was designed to contribute.
I'm listening to you, and I know, Jesse, the thing that I think helps us jive a little bit is you do really good at turning it inward and going, hey, here's the things that I've dealt with. And here's the things that, whether it was abuse or it was bad decisions, things like that. And all of us can relate to that, but I want to make sure we don't miss the fact that we also have dug into that. Some of us, that may not be your first option, is to go and make a choice that maybe hurts ourselves, but we are also dealing with people around us. And I think the balance of it's that internal, you know, decision and how do we reach our personal goals, but also a lot of our goals really have to do with our families and have to do with those people that are close to us. And I think that's what we've identified in this. It's not just, you know, I mean, mental health was a huge conversation last time and how that is in our industry and what that looks like. But mental health is not just, I've got to make sure I take care of my mental health and make sure that I know how to show up every day and make sure that when I leave, I don't take it home with me, but it's the people around us. And whether it's the people at work and how do we identify that and how do we see it and what does that look like? But also when we go home, you know, the people that we love and we care about and how are we showing up for them? And I think that's part of the conversation that led us to this live stream is, you know, when Philip showed up to the Clubhouse conversation. And again, it was the first one he'd shown up to because I think you had it on Facebook. And he showed up and his background was, you know, military and, you know, really just that intervention and being able to help identify some things. And he started talking on Clubhouse. And for me, it resonated, not because I can see how it applies to me personally to help me with my mental health, but with my 10-year-old daughter. And she deals with anxiety. She deals with a lot of different things that as someone who is very high performing and driven and, you know, goal oriented, it's like, you just want to fix it and make it better. You just want to go, that's irrelevant. Yeah, you got this. It's okay. It's not going to hurt you. You're going to like, that's what we do because we just push through. That's our, you know, that's in our DNA. That's how we work. That's how we are where we are. And Philip brought up two things in that conversation that hit me hard because, I mean, I have a 10-year-old that you love and you care about and you want to help them. You want to help them grow. You want to give them tools. And he said, and he was, again, looking at this from a bigger picture on mental health and when you're dealing with people that maybe are dealing with some things that you maybe need to navigate around, he said two things that really hit me. He said, number one, said, you have to be gentle. Yeah. And I don't know about you, but I and the people that I am around with a lot, gentle is probably not one of the top 10 things that someone would describe me as. But you have to be gentle when you're interacting with these people. And so, because they need that care and that compassion. And a lot of times, and again, I mean, I grew up as an athlete. So it's like, oh, shake it off. Oh, your ankle's fine. Walk it off. You're fine. Like that's the mentality that I know. And so when you're dealing with something and it's, you know, and you automatically go, it's not that bad. It's okay. You're going to be okay. And the second thing he said is you have to allow them to have control. And, okay, that sounds okay. No. But like to the point of acknowledging what they're saying, making it real and letting them be, you know, what do you think? And what do you know, how would you do this? And how would you react to this? And after listening to him say those things, I caught myself every day either dismissing or telling it's not that big a deal or stop making it a big deal or also like having to stop and like not let my voice escalate, let my tone escalate. And just, you know, I had to like intentionally do that. And I'm talking about with a 10-year-old. And I mean, we interact with people all day, every day, and we have no idea what is going on in their head. I kind of know what's going on in her head. And so those are just two things that he brought in that hopefully those can resonate with some people. And again, it's not just ourselves and how we deal with it, but how do we deal with those people around us?